All right, it's 11 o'clock and it's time to get going. Good morning, I'm Sarah Kirby from NC State University and NC State Extension. We are thrilled to be able to kick off, I guess, our fifth in our webinar series and the first in our February webinar series on radon. I will serve as the technical host, Philip Gibson, who is the NC radon specialist, and here in North Carolina will serve as your real host and as the man behind all of this, the one that thought of this idea to have this webinar series. I think today will be a good one, just like the other four were, but one that's really interesting because of its focus. I'm going to turn it over to Philip now and let him continue with a little bit more information about the webinar partners, the series, and an introduction to our speaker. So Philip, take it away.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kirby. I want to apologize up front. I am actually sitting in an assisted living facility lobby for the webinar. So if other background noise happens, it's out of my control. But thank you, Dr. Kirby. Thank you once again for sharing your time, your expertise, as always, and making the webinar technology of North Carolina State University available for this important series. To everyone who's attending, thank you for your participation. This session is being recorded and will later be made available on our website at ncradon.org. I want to point out also the support that we've had in reaching various target audiences for this and other webinars. They are represented on this slide, the next slide, Sarah. For this and the remaining February session. So we're really appreciative of their support and getting the word out. While the North Carolina Radon Program began this process with focus on North Carolina, we realized quickly that the subject matter of each of the webinars and the caliber of the professionals who are presenting were important to people outside of North Carolina. So that's why we worked to broadcast it beyond our political boundary here. I want to take a moment and introduce to Hyland our speaker today. Jay started out working for a radon testing company in 1988. He then went on to work for the state of Maine, where he is currently, and he has been the program manager of the radiation control program in Maine since 1998. The radiation control program includes X-ray, radioactive materials, and radon. And Maine has been licensing radon service providers since 1993. Jay has been an active member of the Conference of Radiation Control Program Directors, better known as its acronym, CRCPD, during this time and has been an advisor or a member of all of the radon work groups. So with that, I'll turn it over. Thank you again, Mr. Hyland, for presenting today.
All right, how does that look?
Perfect.
All right. So first, I think to start off, I'd like to welcome you to the Radon channel. I have one more Radon presentation coming up later in the month, so tune in for that too. The other piece is that I have been program manager for quite a while, but I learned from the best. This particular presentation was put together by the state radon coordinator, John Dyer. I just get to deliver it. The Maine's been dealing with radon and water for quite a while. In 1958 was probably the first time that Maine's Department of Human Services at the time, the division that the radiation control program is in, was referred to as health engineering. So that was the time, 58 was the first time we came up with, ultimately it was high radioactivity that they picked it up with a Geiger counter on the water storage tank in their basement. And ultimately it was radon. The level was quite high, over a million. the million peak curies per liter. And I should point out that the National Bureau of Standards had a drinking water standard for radon previous to 1960. And that standard was 2,000 picocuries per liter. When they reprinted their water standards in 1960, they dropped all reference to radon. Over the years, Maine developed a number of different techniques for analyzing radon and removing radon from water. And the University of Maine did a lot of research on radon and water in Maine and elsewhere. The number of the two people at the bottom there, Dr. Hess and Dr. Lowry, anybody who does radon work, anywhere in the country, I suspect, maybe portions of the world would recognize those names. I actually worked with both of them at my time when I was at the university, and I'll talk a little more about that in a few minutes. There's no drinking water standard for radon. That hasn't changed, I guess, since 1960. EPA did propose a standard in 1998, something like that. They proposed a standard of 300. That was based wholly on risk. The radon guidelines that we have today for water and for air are actually not risk-based. As a health agency, when we set a standard, typically we're looking at excess cancers or something to that effect, usually in the order of 1 to a million, 1 to 100,000. Those are the risk numbers that we typically deal with. And in radon, the risk numbers are, 7 per 1,000, things like that. It's a much, orders of magnitude higher risk than any of the other contaminants that we typically deal with. And that's just an emphasis on the fact that the numbers weren't put there based on risk. They were put there based on essentially what we can do with it. We don't have any, there's nobody with a deep pocket that's going to take care of this problem. So the EPA proposal was for public water supplies. And what happened was when they originally proposed it, they got a lot of feedback. And they came forward with what they called a multimedia mitigation program. So if a state had a radon program, they were able to increase their radon water standard to 4,000 based on the fact that somebody was already looking at the air problem. The issue being that radon in the water is just one way that it gets into your house. But what we're really concerned about, the majority of the risk for radon in water actually comes from the radon that gets into the air. So I'll talk more about this, as you're using the water, the radon comes out of the water and gets into the air in your house. So they came back with this multimedia standard of 4,000 picocuries per liter. Estimate is for a single family home is that that would add about 0.4 picocuries per liter to the radon in the air in the home. And so where did they come up with that? Well, that's the background level. That's the background level of radon in outdoor air, 0.4 picocuries per liter. And so the concept was that it didn't make sense to regulate radon to a standard that if you opened up your window in the summertime, you'd be contaminating your home. Talked about that. Anyway, so in Maine, even though, like I said, we first discovered high radon in water back in the 50s, I would say it's probably something like 10% of the homes. In this particular instance, it's 1 to 2%. It's a sort of a national, but in Maine, it's probably closer to 10, maybe even 15% of the homes that get the majority of the radon in the air in the home from their water. I don't believe that we have more of a water problem than other places do, but we do spend a fair amount of time and effort on it. The other piece is, when I talked about the majority of the risk, EPA has calculated that there is some risk due to drinking water with radon in it. They estimate 168 cancer deaths per year. 89% of that actually from lung cancer, and the other 11% is stomach cancer is what they're estimating. And so to put that in perspective, point out that the average adult ingests, you know, something like 2 liters of water a day, whereas we breathe about 20,000 liters of air a day. So the air, you know, it just makes sense. The air is the kind of be the, our primary concern. So the other piece I think I'll point out about the lung cancer and the stomach cancer. So if radon is in your water, you're going to have radon daughter products in your water, and I'm going to talk more about daughter products in a few minutes. But what we found, this was research that was done in health engineering back in the 70s, is that if you drink water with radon in it, you actually breathe the radon out about 20 minutes later. That's just the way your body deals with gases that it doesn't want. But all of the daughter products are not gases, and so you get to keep them. So the way radon gets into water, it's primarily a surface area thing. It appears to be a surface area thing, and I'm going to talk more about surface area in a minute too. There are other radionuclides we find in water, uranium, for example. The recoil concept, radon gives off an alpha particle when it decays. Radium gives off an alpha particle when it decays, which literally kicks the radon off the surface and into the water. Same thing happens with uranium, oddly. What we find in uranium, if you do an isotopic analysis of the uranium in the water, we frequently find uranium-234 at levels that are above what would be its natural abundance. And the only possible explanation for that is this recoil reaction. And secondary would be just diffusion, just the surface area, the water contact with rocks that are high in uranium, radium, and all the daughter products therein. Radon concentration, we're going to talk a little bit about the gas law, what I call the gas law. The laws of partial pressures. And for example, why our lungs are able to pull oxygen out of the air and why we have more trouble with that when we get above 10,000 feet, for example. So the standard gas law stuff that basically radon is going to go from a high concentration to a low concentration. That 68 degree water only holds about a quarter as much radon per liter as a liter of air can hold. And the radon concentration equilibrium between water and air is going to change with
your participant ID followed by pound. Otherwise, just press pound.
Water transfer to air depends on the gas laws. Concentrated is in the water with the surface area between water and air is. The room ventilation rate, the amount of radon that's already in the air, and the size of the room. So EV equals NRT. You're into radon, any gas law. Anyway, so typically when we use the water, the agitation of the water drives the radon out of the water into the air. Dishwashing, typically you're going to get about 98% just because of this agitation. You know, washing machine, because of the hot water, you're going to get more than the cold water. Shower, bath, toilet, these are just sort of typical percentages. Obviously, go back to that previous slide, toilet, if the water sits there long enough, all the radon ultimately will come out. So radon dissolves into the water at the base of the well and out, and, you know, think about this. Now you have a well that's, you know, maybe a few hundred feet deep. And so you're looking at water that's under pressure, and so is the radon. And so when you bring it up and release the pressure and dump it into the sink or the toilet or the dishwasher, radon is going to outgas because of the change in pressure, just like carbonation comes out of soda. So once the radon gets out from wherever the water usage is. You're now looking at it diluted and diffusing into the rest of the air of the building. And some research that was done at the University of Maine, basically that's the 10,000 to 1 ratio. For every 10,000 picocuries per liter in the water, we find that it increases the indoor air of a single family home using the average amount of water by 1 picocuri per liter. And so if you end up testing a home and then mitigating a home, and you still have a radon problem, test the water. Frequently what we do is we test the air and the water together to come up with a plan of attack. So now we're going to get to the treatment methods, which is what this presentation was really all about. The treatment methods for residential homes are typically these last two are the ones we see the most of. Decay and storage is certainly an option. If you have a big enough storage tank, you can hold water until the radon decays. It just takes time. But aeration and GAC, granular activated carbon, are the typical. And aeration is considered by EPA to be best available technology. So the decay and storage, radon has a half-life of 4 days. If you can hold the radon up for 8 days, you're looking at 2 half-lives, you're gonna end up with about 75% reduction. And so a family of 4 would need, 1,600 to 2,400 gallon storage tank, which might be problematic. So the aeration methods, they all work basically the same way. How they get their air in contact with the water changes. So the packed column, that's the, I guess what I would call an older aeration method. I don't know if anybody is still doing that today, but the spray, diffused bubbles, and shallow aeration is what most of the aeration systems that are used today typically do. So just a sort of a look at the different methods. The water comes in at the top, trickles down through. The idea here is surface area, surface area, surface area. You want to get as much surface area of the water exposed to the air that's coming in at the bottom and coming out the top along with the radon. And then the water, obviously with any of these aeration methods, you're going to be depressurizing the water to allow the radon to come out more efficiently. And but you're going to have to then pump the water out of wherever it is you're aerating it and pump it back up to pressure. So you're going to need another jet pump and another pressure tank for it to be used in the home. The aeration, another aeration method is just a spray aeration. You got some sort of a spray nozzle, an air blower, same concept as the packed tower. And then the water's pumped out of the bottom. The radon's vented outside. The probably the thing I should point out about aeration is that all of the methods really depend on chemistry, quite honestly. So when you're aerating water, what's going to happen is you're going to oxidize the water. So if there are any metals dissolved in the water, like iron or manganese, those metals are going to become metal oxides, which are much less soluble than the metals that came in, so to speak. In the water line. And so they're all going to basically plate out. They're all going to precipitate out. You're going to find them, at the bottom of your aeration system. And so the aeration system is going to have to be cleaned out on a regular basis so that you don't end up with a problem with all of these things. And not usually a problem. It's just a regular maintenance issue for these systems. But I'm bringing it up because of an upcoming slide, which I'll talk about in a minute. So the more you can recycle the spray, so to speak, if you want increased removal efficiency, the more you spray it, the more surface area, more air, more radon is removed. And then the diffuse bubble. One of the problems with aeration systems, and you saw it with the first two, is that the deeper your bubbles are being created underwater, the more pressure your air pump is going to need. And so this one is going to need a compressor. It doesn't just need a fan. The other ones would just run on a fan. And so those are thoughts to consider on the different systems. Basically, they all make changes with regards to how much noise the systems make and things like that. They all, like I said, do basically the same thing and have a very similar efficiencies. And so there are a number of systems out there. We recommend to anybody that look at them all. The shallow tray, basically it's easier, just an air blower. Now we're back to an air blower instead of a compressor because it's shallow. It's a shallow tray. It's a fan is all you need to blow through about an inch of water. When you start talking about feet of water, you need something more. So the air is blown up through holes in the tray, and then the water drains down to the bottom of the system where it's pumped up to pressure again to be used in the house. These systems typically do have a number of controls, like float switches, air switches. Usually they're the radon that's going to outside of the house. There's usually a vent fan on this, just like there is for a radon air mitigation system. The idea is you don't want these high levels of radon sort of leaking into your basement. The reason that's important, even if levels are low, if water usage is high, you're going to see incredibly high levels. And examples for that in the state of Maine that we've seen, fish hatcheries. If they're using groundwater instead of surface water, for their fish, they have to aerate the water. They're going to aerate the water no matter where they get it from. But if they have to aerate the water and they're using groundwater, you're going to see a higher radon concentration in that water, which is going to equate to very high levels of radon in the air in the fish hatchery buildings. But any water handling system, even if you're maybe you have a somebody who sells bottled water. If they're getting water from a well, even if the radon in that water is only, 200 picocuries per liter, way below the standard, they're handling thousands of gallons a day, and so it equates to real radon levels. Another aeration method, which is a little bit different, all these previous methods that I talked about were systems that are typically installed in your basement or in a utility room. This particular method is actually has come out of Canada. We're still trying to evaluate it. There actually have been some installs of this particular method in the state of Maine. And this is, we'll get back to why I brought up those oxidized metals in a second. So this particular aeration method, what they do is they actually install this right in the well. So you have a pipe that goes all the way down to the bottom of the well. And then you'll have this sort of U-shaped thing where air comes in and it enters into the larger pipe that goes to the bottom of the well. And as the air rises up through that pipe, it pulls water up from the bottom of the well. And then the air comes out the slots in the top of this pipe. And then that air is vented out through the top of the well head. The issues are you're going to see relatively high radon release rates at ground level, so we wouldn't recommend putting a deck right there for people to hang out on. The reason they've been installed in the state of Maine is usually a space thing. there's been a lot of renewed interest, shall we say, in small houses. And so these houses don't have room for a water treatment system. And these things don't take up any room in the house at all. Maybe increasing the radon level in the air in your backyard. The other concerns we have is obviously the oxidation of the water in the well, which is going to cause this manganese or iron or, like I said, any other metal you might have in the water to precipitate out at the bottom of the well, which ultimately that's where your well pump is. Our concern is that over time it may increase the risk of well pump failure. Granular activated carbon, research that we did back in the 80s, basically the carbon we found that was the best at this was coconut shell carbon. It's what they call adsorption as opposed to absorption. It's more of a, rather than the radon becoming part of the carbon, the radon's just sort of held up in the micropores that are present on the carbon surface. And so we're going to talk a little more about water chemistry, but essentially you need a fair amount of carbon to get this to work. What you'll find is that people with public water supplies will frequently use a maybe a small carbon filter on their kitchen faucet just to take out the chlorine leftovers, if you will, that are in the public water supply. Those small filters aren't going to remove any radon because they just don't have the surface area. Typically, you're going to need 1.5 to 2 cubic feet of carbon to remove any significant quantity of radon from the water. These carbon systems I've seen are different as well. I've seen the water come in at the top. I've seen it come in at the bottom. But ultimately, it's just a surface area thing. If you have enough carbon, it will remove radon. It also removes a lot of the volatile organics. And so in the state of Maine, there have been a number of wells where they've installed carbon filters specifically because of a volatile organic spill, maybe a well that's just down gradient from a junkyard or something like that. And so these systems are put in, specifically to address volatile organics, but they're going to remove radon as well. So what are the differences in these systems? The GAC has advantages and disadvantages. Advantages are that you don't need as much stuff. It doesn't take up as much room. It doesn't take up any power, for example. These other systems are going to be running fans and pumps. So they're less expensive to install initially. Typically, we see GAC install prices $1,500 in that vicinity. And in all of these systems I'm going to talk about, because of the water chemistry, there may be other things you have to do to your water before you can actually install any of these radon systems. The oxidation of metals in the water. So if you have a lot of iron or manganese, they may put a water softener in place first in an effort to try to bring that level down some so that your aeration system doesn't become clogged with these oxidized metals. But the same thing happens with GAC. What we see is over time is that the efficiency of the GAC units, the carbon units to remove radon, actually drops over time because of all of these other things that sort of clog up the pores, if you will, on the surface of the carbon. So typically we see, like I said, 1500, 1800, but it depends. If they have to install additional things before the GAC unit, obviously it's going to cost more money. So the other issue with GAC really has to do with, diminished performance over time. The GAC units, because they're literally holding on to the radon, they end up with a fair amount of deposition of these radon daughter products. And some of these daughter products do emit gamma rays. And so it's one of these things you have to be concerned about. You don't want to place a GAC unit, on the opposite side of a wall from where somebody's bed is, for example. That would not be the Alara. That would be, Alara means lowest achievable level, if you will, as low as reasonably achievable is what Alara means. But basically you don't want to expose people to radiation that they don't need. So you've got some gamma ray issues, but what we found, like I said, with the RDEP, Department of Environmental Protection, installing these units for volatile organic removal, what we found is if they're in place, and some of them have been in place for 10, 15, 20 years, they don't remove radon anymore. So the performance, when you first install them, you might get 90, 95%. And if you take care of any other issues that you may have with the water beforehand, they may maintain that performance for a period of time. But ultimately, over time, that does diminish. If these things become so contaminated, you've got a problem with disposal costs. At some point in time, you're going to run into trouble with how you're going to get rid of these things. It's low-level waste. So I talked a little bit about the price on GAC units. Aeration units are much more expensive. You're looking at $3,500, $5,000 per unit. Like I said, if they have to install additional filtration stuff, you might be up to $7,000 a unit. So the GAC units are cheaper up front, But you have to replace that carbon. Typically in Maine, what they do is they replace the carbon before it becomes low-level waste, and so they can just dispose of it at a local landfill. The problem is carbon's expensive too. So the carbon price, you're looking at anywhere from about $400 a cubic foot, and if you have a 2-cubic foot system, you're looking at $800 to recarbon the system. Aeration units don't have that problem. They do have annual maintenance, and they do use up electricity, but they're not going to cost that amount of money to service. So, that said, I'm available for questions. We haven't completely run out of time because I always talk too long.
If you have questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box. I will say while you're typing, Philip wants you to know that everyone who is on this webinar will be receiving a certificate for attending. And so if you need that for continuing education credits, you can submit that yourself to the accrediting body that you wish to. Here's one question, Jay. Are there any regulations or specific standards for disposal of radon in GAC systems?
Yes, but frequently they're going to be state specific. In the state of Maine, there are a number of different ways you can license a landfill. In the state of Maine, we don't have any of the hazardous waste landfills. And so the A, B, C, D, anyway, and so because of that, our landfills do not accept any radioactive material. That's what the regulations say. But quite honestly, everything's radioactive. And so there's radioactive stuff going into the landfill all the time. But if you have something that you know is radioactive, then no, you're not allowed to dispose of it that way. And so typically what we do is we keep it below the definition. There's actually a definition of what is radioactive material. It appears in DOT regulations, and it's 2,000 picocuries per gram. And so it's a fairly low number, but you can, as long as you change out the carbon in these GAC units. In Maine, typically, it's about every 2 years, depending on the water usage and the radon level. But you can dispose of them in a regular landfill.
Okay. Are the treatment options you detailed typical across the nation, or are they specific to Maine?
I believe they're typical across the nation, only because the aeration units that I highlighted, other than the one in Canada, the aeration units they're not manufactured in Maine. They're manufactured by, large corporations.
Okay. For activated carbon, what is the empty bed contact time design criteria? What is the empty bed contact time design criteria?
That's a very interesting question. I don't honestly know. What I can tell you, though, is that we don't see adequate radon removal until we get up above a cubic foot and a half. So like I said, typically we see 1.5 to 2 cubic feet of carbon per system. The typical single-family homes using something like 200 gallons a day, I'm guessing contact times could be on the order of hours, but it doesn't... We're not seeing radon levels in the water change, even if you're running the well for, a long shower or something, after running it through the carbon systems. So it appears to be less a contact time thing and more a surface area thing.
Okay. Does Maine have a worker safety program specified for techs servicing GAC systems on a regular basis?
Not specific to GAC systems, no. There is some radiation standards for their worker safety, but not specifically to GAC systems.
Okay. Has testing been done using an ozonator? And if so, has it been successful?
Nothing that I know of.
Okay. If pretreatment includes water softening, can radon become trapped within the softener housing? And if radon is present in the well water, should the owner test for other radionuclides?
We don't see We don't see an issue with the softener. What I will say is that there's one other issue with GAC units that I didn't talk about, and that has to do with these things that that are radon daughter products that are plated out on the carbon. The groundwater in Maine is typically acidic, and so what we see is that these radioactive metals become soluble at high enough levels in the carbon. They become soluble again in the water. And so there's actually a program out there called CarbDose that was originally created by EPA, a guy named Stan Rydell. And the CarbDose program used to do calculations for what the gamma ray exposure rates were. And it was just a standard stoichiometric equation. It just balanced mass. And so, but what we found is that the levels, the gamma levels were always lower than what CarbDose predicted. And so that that brought up the search for why. And the answer is that the radon daughter products tend to leach back into the water off the GAC units, particularly in water that's acidic. So the bed, because it's carbon, is going to be initially a basic thing. And so if your water is basic, it should hold the daughter products for a longer period of time. But if your water is acidic, one more thing you have to think about. The other thing is that any system that backwashes, we do have some ion exchange systems, for example, that are used to remove arsenic or uranium or something from water. The backwash line can't be in contact with a sewer line. There has to be an air gap. And so we've actually had systems with air gaps that the amount of radon coming off of the backwash is enough to elevate the radon level in the house. Just okay. Because of that air gap, it gets back into the basement.
Is spring water also an issue?
Anything could be an issue. It all depends on what the radon level is in the water and how much water you're dealing with. Like I said, if you have a spring, the water, even if it has 200 picocuries per liter, not an issue in your house. But if you're a bottling plant and you're dealing with, you know, 1 million gallons a day, all of a sudden that's a lot of radon.
My home has a bubble up junior. My radon in water was at 89,900 picocuries per liter. I'll be drawing a sample to test uranium today. Is there anything else that I should be testing for?
Okay, I didn't answer one of the questions. One of the questions had to do with, is radon related to any other radionuclides in water? We haven't seen a direct relation between radon and the other nuclides, radionuclides in water. But typically, the things that aren't universally tested for that I would recommend, we have seen some correlation between uranium and arsenic. If you have uranium, you frequently have arsenic. I don't know if that's true nationwide, but we've seen that in Maine. And so my recommendation is uranium and then a gross alpha test. The reason for the gross alpha is that the other radionuclides in water, radionuclide analysis in a lab is usually very expensive. Uranium is not, because they use what's called a mass spec do that analysis. So it's relatively cheap, but you can't do that for the everything. It works for uranium, but it doesn't work for all the other radionuclides. And so the gross alpha, what that'll do for you is it'll give you a quick scan to see if you've got maybe radium or some other radionuclide in the water that you should be concerned about. And it's cheaper. Our radionuclide isotopic analysis is on the order of like $180, whereas a gross alpha is on the order of like $30.
Someone has asked about labs for testing radon, and Philip has put the link for all the labs that are available for testing radon, the listing for that. So if you look down in the chat box, you should all be able to access that. And then another question is, I've had my well water tested at the University of Georgia, and it was just under 306 picocuries per liter, which they were advised was slightly high. However, the radon in their house is 0.8 picocuries per liter. So they don't know if they need to invest in an aeration at this point. GAC doesn't seem to be a viable option. Do you have any thoughts related to that?
Yeah, the so with a 300 in the water, you're looking at that, the water is adding something like 0.03 to the air in the home. And so if you have a 0.8 in the air in the home, water's not your issue. I wouldn't worry. I would be quite happy with a radon water level like 306. With a 0.8 in the air in the home, obviously you're much less than 4, which is the guideline level. I'd be pretty happy with those numbers, actually.
That is the end of all the questions. I do want to thank you so much for being a part of our webinar today, Jay. Your information has been amazingly fantastic. We have had lots of questions, I know, here in North Carolina related to radon and water, in particular the county that we're in Wake County. So we look forward to hearing you again in about 2 weeks. And the next week we have another presentation on radon to look forward to. So thank you all for attending, and we look forward to seeing you next week.
Thank you, Dr. Kirby.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phyllis.